morning. Our first reading of the Old Testament is from Numbers chapter 11, verses 24 through 30. It can be found on page 129 in your pew Bibles. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 men of the elders of the people and placed them round about the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was upon him and put it upon the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did so no more. Now two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad. And the spirit rested upon them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent. And so they prophesied in the camp. And the young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, the son of Nun, the minister of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord Moses, forbid them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put his spirit upon them?" And Moses and the elders of Israel returned to the camp. The epistle lesson is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 3 through 13. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Jesus be cursed." And no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of working, but it is the same God who inspires them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. So another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are inspired by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. The gospel reading today is from John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and proclaimed, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water." Here ends the word of the Lord.
Well, grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father, and the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I really liked that song. Down by the riverside, it was kicking. One of the things that struck me this week in some conversations I had were comments that I had heard from some folks. I was in a conversation with a very devout Christian, not of this church or denomination, who said, "Well, it's a big Sunday, Pentecost." I said, "Yes, it is." And he said, "Well, it's important to celebrate the birthday of the Holy Spirit." church, sure. Holy Spirit's been from all eternity and forever part of the Trinity. And then I was in a presbytery committee meeting yesterday, and one of the elders in that meeting said, you know what I don't like about these special days? And I thought, okay, here we go. Well, I don't like the fact that, you know, we get to hear the same story over again. I mean, we all know the story of Pentecost. We all know the story of Christmas. We all know the story of Easter. And I thought for a moment, I said, well, could this be the Spirit of the Lord speaking to me, even if I don't like it? And I thought, what would be something really out of the ordinary to do on Pentecost? And so I decided that I'd like to preach today on the book of Numbers, the Old Testament lesson. How often do you get to hear an Old Testament lesson preached on, let alone how many book of Numbers sermons have you ever heard? Wow. The story that you heard read today occurs at a place called Kibroth Hattaava. That's the location where the people of Israel were encamped. And sometimes the name of a place gives you a sense of what's going to go on in the story that you're told. Kibroth Hattaava means the grave of craving. Nice touch. It sounded pretty romantic and exotic before, but now not so much. The grave of craving. For you see, Moses, God's anointed leader and prophet over Israel, had of course brought the people of Israel out of the land of bondage in Egypt. He had led them away from slavery, and then after a course of several events, they were destined to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. They were a trying lot. The scripture says they were stiff-necked, which is a Hebraic euphemism. We have our own euphemisms for such people. Let's just stick with the one, pain in the neck. The neck. Even though God had freed them from slavery, even though God had cared for them, even though God had provided for them, guess what? They complained bitterly. They complained about everything. They complained about the heat, the toil. They complained about the privation. They were afflicted by lightning, and many were killed after they had had a particularly difficult session with God about the way God was running God's world. And then when they were hungry, they complained about that. So God gave them manna every day, regularly collected manna, manna that could be taken and treated in several different ways, but it was always the same thing. It was manna. Now, why is this place called Kibroth Hattaava, the grave of craving? Because they rise up against Moses, and they start giving him the business. And they rise up against God and say things like, oh, do you remember the fish we had in Egypt? Do you remember the fowl we had in Egypt? Do you remember the meat of Egypt? What do we have here? Man, oh man, oh man. Ah, the human condition. Well, this has been going on for years. And Moses has just had as much as he can possibly take. He says, I alone am not able to bear this whole people, for it is too heavy for me. If you will deal in this way with me, kill me here and now. And if I find favor in your sight, O God, that I might not see my misfortune. Sometimes I counsel clergy who are having a hard time, and one of the litmus tests is, do you wish you were dead rather than be the pastor of that church? Moses wishes that God would either change the circumstances and help him with the loneliness of leadership, or that he would die. Just take his life, Lord. That's what he says. God doesn't like this conversation very much. God is pretty put out with the people of Israel. He's heard their cries, their lamentations, and their complaints, and God is displeased. And God doesn't really like the fact that Moses has come to such a state. For he had given Moses Holy Spirit, and yet his Holy Spirit is being overwhelmed by the loneliness and the burden of leadership. So God gives Moses instruction. That's what you heard today. He says, go get 70 elders and have them come out to the tabernacle, which is on the edge of the camp. Now do the math. There are 12 tribes of Israel. If Moses selects 6 people from each of the tribes, you get 70 elders, right? No, it's okay. You can say no when I'm preaching. I used to get that a lot when I was a young man. No! But no, it isn't, is it? God says 70 elders. And so Moses is placed in a bit of a dilemma. How's he going to manage this? Well, he does, in fact, according to tradition, gather 6 from each of the tribes. And then he has them do a process of drawing straws. And 2 are eliminated. So in the passage, it says that the 2 were registered, but not in the meeting. That's because they drew the short straw. So there's a meeting with God. And it says in the scripture that God takes a portion of the spirit that had been given to Moses and places it upon the 70. And Moses is no longer alone in leadership. He shares it with the 70. And they begin to prophesy so that there's evidence that they have the Holy Spirit of God upon them. Now, it's a thing about Holy Spirit. If you take part of it from one person and place it on another, does that mean that somehow their degree of Holy Spirit is diminished? No. It's still all there for Moses. But now it's also there with the 70 elders over Israel. They prophesy. It's there. It's in evidence. The Spirit is poured out on the 70. But they stop prophesying. So we know the Spirit's there, but we know there's limitations. Well, guess what? Meanwhile, back at the ranch, meanwhile, back in the camp of Israel, those 2 fellas that were eliminated but registered, they start to prophesy too. They're not at the tabernacle. But God has given them an abundance of Holy Spirit, and they prophesy and prophesy and prophesy. They do not stop. Now, wait a minute. You see, the Israelites were the precursors of Presbyterians. We have an order here, decently and in order, and this isn't working out. Who are these 2 upstarts prophesying out in the camp? People start running around. What's going on? They go to Joshua, who eventually succeeds Moses, and Joshua, son of Nun, is told, these guys are prophesying. But that's not the game plan. Somebody's called a Holy Spirit audible. What in the world's going on? You better get back to good old Moses and tell him to turn off the path that these 2 guys are tapping into. And Joshua goes, of course, to Moses. And Joshua says, my Lord Moses, prevent them. Has a little Shakespearean feel to it. My Lord Moses, prevent them. And Moses says, are you jealous on my account? And he says, oh, that I would that all the people of Israel would prophesy and that God would put God's Spirit on them. Moses is not upset about this change in plans. The rabbis ask, why would God have Moses pick 70 when God knew he was going to do 72? Well, the 70 was a test. And in some sense, a little thing that reestablishes Moses' sense of leadership. And the 72, the two additional ones, is the most profound theological statement regarding the intent of God towards God's people. The most profound theological statement about the direction that God's going toward in pouring out his Spirit on flesh. Did you catch the names of those two guys? One was named Eldad. The other one was named Medad. Curious that the names sound similar, isn't it? Eldad means God has loved. God has loved you two who appear to be pushed out and just left behind among the people. And Medad means beloved. God has loved, and beloved were the two that were excluded and remained in the camp. God has loved, and beloved are the two who prophesy in abundance. God has loved, and beloved are the two who demonstrate an abundance of God's Holy Spirit evidenced in the midst of the people. All tribes in the camp. Moses gets it. The trajectory of God is to pour out God's Holy Spirit on all believers. And that's what happens. That's what happens on Pentecost Sunday. As for the rest of the story, God also says to Moses, do you think that you understand that God's hand is short, that there's a limitation to God's power? And so God does, in fact, say, okay, you don't like manna, Israel? And God gives them quail for a month. The problem is, when they start to eat the quail, they are afflicted with some disease, and many of them die. You see, God knows what's best for us, and God's provision sustains us. So it is not simply enough to have Holy Spirit. It is enough to have Holy Spirit and to obey God. Trust God, and know that the God who made us loves us, and that God's will is sufficient for us. It is not the Holy Spirit's birthday. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity, and has always been in evidence and in activity. Among God's people. You have the Holy Spirit because you are in Christ. But more importantly, guess what? The Holy Spirit has a hold of you. Remember your call to leadership, the variety of gifts that are given us, and in the Holy Spirit of God, march forth with confidence, sharing the responsibilities and duties, privileges and opportunities as a Christian people.